And the devil has never recovered from its sins. I hate Lucifer. And I love Jesus. Don't you love Jesus? Don't you love the people of God, saints? So our brother read in Genesis 11, God came down and saw the Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. Mike and I had lengthy discussions about this. We knew what was going on back then, didn't we, Mike, right? Demonic activity was happening in the earth at that time. And so God wanted Adam and Eve's children to have dominion over the earth. And God is the one who confounded their one language. Remember, they all spoke one language. The King James Version says they were all of one lip or one tongue. So God is the author of the languages. Ever wonder? Our sister speaks Portuguese. I speak Italian. Some of you speak French. Where do those languages come from? It came from God. God did business and drove them and ended their enterprise there in Babylon. I like rockabilly music. I like Stray Cats. And I love their group Apologetics. Anybody ever seen Apologetics? So they take Rock This Town Tonight, and it's a parody of how God created and, languages and destroyed the work of Nimrod at the Tower of Babel. If you want to go on YouTube.
I'll get it up on the Facebook page this afternoon. So everyone can see it.
So now you have all these millions of people, hundreds of millions, eventually a billion people, and they're spread all over the earth. Remember, they come from one family, Noah. Noah didn't have a black son, a Chinese son, and an Anglo son. He had three children, and they intermarried. And when you intermarry, you develop strains and characteristics physically. And those characteristics became pronounced more and more and more, generation after generation. And then, of course, Ham, you know the story of Ham going to Africa and part of the Fertile Crescent. Seth, the Shemites, and Japheth becoming Caucasians and the Europeans. The Acts chapter 2 is the reversing of the curse of the Tower of Babel. Remember, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, the Bible says that God told, Jesus told his disciples to what? Stay and hang around and have church in Jerusalem forever and ever and just be self-centered, inward thinking. Is that what our Savior told us?
No.
To church, what did Jesus say?
Go.
He said, wait.
Go and follow me, amen? Go into some parts of the world that are comfortable. Go into what part of the world?
All
the world. How are they going to go into all the world? Here's how. Acts chapter 1, Jesus says, you're going to go into all the world. But you're not going to go until I send the promise of the Father. In Acts 14 and Acts 16. So let us now look into the sacred text as we look into Acts, the second chapter. This is part one of two sermons on Pentecost. Next Sunday will be Pentecost Sunday, part two. Historical background, this is the Festival of Weeks, Leviticus chapter 23, verse 15, 7 weeks after first fruits. And when we think of the Passover, Jesus fulfills Passover. Jesus dies as the Passover lamb. Then we have first fruits. Jesus is resurrected on the Feast of First Fruits. Now Jesus is the living word. We are reading the written word. And the Bible says in John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was, is, and ever shall be God. That's the tense in the Greek. Hello, Jehovah's Witnesses. And so Jesus is God incarnate. But in Acts chapter 2, the Spirit is incarnating God's people. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Just like Jesus took a body, the Spirit incarnated the body of Christ. Amen? He comes into the lives of 120 people. He's not just over them, hovering over them. He's not just a hand of God on them. He's going to reach a world. And this is the first, not Baptist church, Pentecostal church, congregational church. This is the first Holy Ghost Christian church. This is a church possessed by God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
This is not a dead church. This is the first church on fire for God. If we're going to reach a world, we got to be possessed by God. You got to be, I got to be, we got to be totally in control, filled, and used and possessed by God. We got to think His way. We got to act His way. We got to have God's mind for lost people in our community. Amen?
Yes.
And so God says, I got a community. It's called the world, and you're going to reach it. There are 120 of them in a massive room. Maybe it was a room this size. You don't know. And it's right adjacent to the temple. And in that room, they're waiting for God. A mighty sound, like the sound of a mighty rushing wind, moves. Remember what Jesus said in John chapter 3 to Nicodemus? The Spirit moves where it will. You can't see it, but it's a wind. This is not a gentle breeze. This is all heaven breaking loose. This is heaven came down and glory filled my soul. This is God moving into His house. Who's His house? You're His house. I'm His house. He's the landlord of the house. And when He moves in, He's going to give us the power to live for God. And we need this power. So let us think about this Christian unity. What is it? It's people loving each other very kindly. Christian unity requires three things: forgiveness, fellowship, focus. Forgiveness, fellowship, focus. Well, what do you mean forgiveness? Well, first of all, sometimes you gotta forgive yourself. There's 120 brothers and sisters, and 11 of them forsook Jesus. What's it like for a church to see their pastors backslide or just leave? You see, some people had to forgive each other, didn't they? The apostles were probably asking each other, will you forgive me? I can't believe I walked away from Jesus when He needed me the most. I'm sure there was some forgiveness going on. Amen? Maybe the apostles were asking forgiveness of the other 108. But forgiveness is very important in the church of Jesus. Do not forget to forgive. Always honor brothers and sisters ahead of yourself. If you treat others better than yourself, you will be sensitive to always forgive. They had forgiven each other. Man, when we get right with God, God opens up the windows of heaven and now begins to pour something out. Forgiveness we need. We also need fellowship. They're together praying, and they're crying out to God for God to do something powerful. They don't understand the Spirit is like we understand the Holy Spirit right now. But the Spirit's going to possess them. And then Jesus said, when He comes, you'll have no reason to ask me any other further questions. Amen? So they have forgiven each other. They're fellowshipping with each other. And now God sees that and the Spirit of God falls. Why is that important for our church today? Because in the Moravian church in Saxony, Germany, the people had offended each other. Well, they had a communion service like we're having today. Before they had communion, people were breaking down in the pews. And the pastor said, we're not going to have the service until people apologize. You know what? Everybody apologized to themselves. People were weeping for 20, 30 minutes. You know what happened? Right after the service, they sent missionaries all over the world. They evangelized more than the entire Christian church had done since the Protestant Reformation. Listen, when we forgive each other, when we are a people that fellowship and We honor each other, we care for each other, we love each other, we bear with one another. Oh, the Father likes that. The Father likes when his children get along. Amen? When his kids get along, man, the Spirit falls. And when the Spirit falls, our lives are never the same again. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And somehow the Spirit is about now to fall on them. And the Spirit now comes here on the festival of weeks, Pentecost. He fills the believers. And Peter, who was once the one who betrayed Jesus, is now forgiven. Man, you know what happens when you ask God for forgiveness and you come clean? Satan can't bring that up anymore. That sin's been dealt with because we did business with God. Amen? Now the man was once full of fear. And we've been like that. Haven't we been full of fear sometimes? Now this man is full of faith. And man, when you're full of faith, God can move. God can move and do great and mighty things. I want to talk to you about the sounds, sights, and speeches of Pentecost. The sounds, the sights. What am I doing?
Fire.
Fire and the speeches. Let's talk about the sounds, the sights, and the speeches of Pentecost. We see here in Acts chapter verses 1 and 2, there's a mighty wind that comes. And everyone, I believe, and many Bible students believe, this sound was like a railroad train coming through Jerusalem. When God's people and local churches get on fire, you know what? Everyone in the community around that church knows something is happening. Some people know something's happening in the Watch Out Congregational Church. Want to know why? Because we've been knocking on their doors and telling them Jesus loves them. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen? The sound of devils running because God's people are getting serious about doing the work of the ministry. Mm-hmm. Sounds. The sights. What do they see? All of a sudden, the 120. What's happening? The Spirit of God who brought chaos and brought order out of chaos in the creation in Genesis 1 is now above and ready now to possess and indwell God's believers. Why must we be indwelt by the Spirit? For service to the King. That's why. The Spirit is sent to live in you. Why? Because you need His power. I need His power to serve God in these last and evil days. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen? You need power. Oh my God, this church needed power. Everybody hates them. Romans crucified Jesus who was risen from the dead. The Jews can't wait to persecute this little church. 120 people, used to be one, used to be 12, was 70, was 82, now it's 120. And they got things to do, people to see, and a mission to accomplish. And they need to be emboldened. And now they see tongues of fire. Fire? The Bible says our God is a consuming
fire.
Moses met at the burning bush. He saw a bush that was burning, but what happened?
It was not consumed.
It didn't get consumed. When they walked out of Egypt, a cloud by day, and what did they see at night?
Pillar of fire.
Fire! And if a church is going to touch people in a community, for God's sake and for my sake and yours, you have got to be set on fire by the Spirit of God. Listen, it can't come from within the flesh. I don't care if you're Italian like me and Don. That's good. That helps. Southern Mediterraneans get emotional, but you know what? Your emotions, after a while, you crash. What is going to light your fire? Jose Feliciano, light my fire! Light my fire! Who's going to light the fire? God is going to light the fire. The fire that was seen by the Hebrews is the fire that lives in us. You meet a person that's full of the Spirit, they're on fire. They're a man and a woman with no more fear, but with faith. Now, the crowd is unbelievably confused. Why is the crowd confused? They come from three different continents. And they hear, in verses 5 through 10, they're hearing Galileans who speak Aramaic speaking in their own language. Listen, back then, 2,000 years ago, nobody spoke everybody else's language. Nobody. Everybody spoke their own dialect. If you were a merchant, if you were a businesswoman, a businessman, a government official, everybody spoke Greek. From Spain to India, everybody spoke Greek. These people are not just speaking Greek. These 120 are filled with God. They're speaking in a known language, and everybody is hearing it. And there are thousands of people hearing it. And they are astonished. Kenneth Weiss, in his translation, says they are astonished beyond understanding. This had never occurred since the time of Babel. How can people from different languages hear the glorious gospel of God? The Holy Spirit is possessed people. Whenever you study doctrine, any doctrine, it's important to understand the principle of first mention. When we speak about the gift of tongues, here's the first mention. Now, this is not a heavenly tongue. That's another discussion and a sermon for another time in 1 Corinthians 14. This, they all understand what everyone's talking about. Can I get an amen? Yeah. This is the real gift of tongues. Well, I don't want to say that. Strike that. This is the original gift of tongues. I should correct myself. The original gift of tongues is given so that people who don't know Jesus can come to Jesus. So there's confusion. So now the Apostle Peter gives clarification. He's a speaker, makes a statement, and he goes right to the Word of God. Listen, if we're going to get answers about life, anything that's troubling you, what was that movie? The Princess Bride. Remember that?
Yeah.
What vexeth thee? There are things that vex us. There are things that confuse us. And we remain confused until such time as we exercise. Listen, if you want to get muscles, what do? Exercise. You have some weight. You want to build yourself up in the most holy faith? Be not ignorant of Satan's devices, the Bible says. We're ignorant because we don't study to show ourselves approved. Amen? That's not just for the pastor, that's everybody. Amen? Because we're all ministers of reconciliation. We've got to bone up. We've got to study up. So now, the Bible, at this time, there is no New Testament. What is Peter using to preach that? He's a Jew. Who's he preaching to?
Jews
and proselyte Jews from Italy and Greece and Asia and Libya and Egypt. And there are Arabians, Mesopotamians, Elamites, and Persians, and they're all coming up. These are people who forsook wicked idolatry. And now he begins to prove to them from the Tanakh, the Old Testament, that when David was writing, he's not writing about himself. He says, David's right here. His tomb is right here. He isn't resurrected. What has happened? It was prophesied by the prophet Joel and David in Psalm 110 that this is the resurrection of Christ Jesus from the dead. This is the creator of the universe who came to destroy the works of Satan. He's risen. And we're 120 out of 500 that saw him. We're 25% of a half a thousand people that walk with you. We didn't just see Jesus for a couple of minutes. We spoke to him for 40 days, 40 nights. And these people, you cannot stop people that are possessed by God. Amen? And he says, listen, there's some things I want you to know. I want you to know the Messiah, Christ Jesus, was crucified by his enemies and foes. But that's not the end of the story. Christ Jesus, the Messiah, was resurrected by the Father. And we are his witnesses, and we have been given eternal life. We are now telling you, you are the ones who are here.
Amen.
They stayed. They came early. Many of those who we preached to probably said, crucify him, crucify him. Don't know for sure. Can't dogmatically say that, but there's a possibility. How do you know that, Pastor? Glad you asked the question. Because as he preaches to them in verse 37, look, it says, now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were found guilty of crucifying the Messiah that they were waiting Can you imagine if that was near you? They're trembling and listen, you know, the kind of gospel teaching that you got to have in a church is preaching on repentance and faith in Christ. No such thing as easy believism. People don't appreciate mercy and the grace of God until their hearts have been cut and slain and they find themselves guilty before God. Isn't that what Paul said to the Roman church? In Romans chapter 3, there is none that is righteous, no?
Not one.
They're all guilty. The day I gave my life to Jesus, April 3rd, 1977, the Spirit of God caught me to the heart. He said, Renzo, you are guilty of the blood of Jesus Christ. What do you mean? He died for your sins, you miserable sinner. And it was like God hung me over hell all day long that day. And that day, I fell on my knees and I begged Jesus Christ to save me. Why did I come to faith in Christ? Because Christians evangelized me. It didn't happen because of osmosis. I didn't just walk by a church and the power just left and I just got swept up in it. The Bible says, how can they hear without a
preacher?
And how can you have a preacher unless he is sent? God sent a preacher from Florida to preach to me. And a Christian from First Baptist Church in East Long Middle to preach to me. And another Christian from the Christian Adventist Church on Sumner Avenue. They all preached to me. And because I heard the word of God, faith cometh by
hearing.
Hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I was caught to the heart. When you're sharing the gospel with people, don't put the sword of the Lord in your sheath. Take it out. You give out the word. The word, you gotta tell them about repentance. We gotta tell people about sin. Amen? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You know how many churches America is full with pastors that won't say repent? What is wrong with them? If you want to say repent, for God's sake, get out of the ministry. Get the heaven out of the ministry. That's like being a doctor and you know, you got a cure for cancer. Your patient's got cancer. I'm gonna tell you got cancer. Okay, you're all set. Next. You get sued for mal.
Practice.
I wonder if we're gonna, how many of us get sued? You know what I'm saying? Sued for mal. Practice. We gotta practice. We gotta be, listen, preach the word of God. Don't make apologies to people. Amen? I'm going to heaven because three people told me the truth. Cut to the heart. People need to be cut to the heart. And so they ask, what must I do? Oh my gosh, I'm guilty. What must I do? See, the Spirit's number one work in a human being is conviction. Jesus said in John chapter 14 and John chapter 16 that the Spirit brings conviction of judgment and righteousness and the things to come. Man, the day I got saved, I was convicted all day long of judgment, all day long of His righteousness and how unrighteous I was. Man, I came to Jesus because the Spirit convicted me. When we share the gospel, we got to give people the Bible. We go out and give out the gospel of John. When they read the gospel of John, they're going to be convicted by the Spirit, amen? Whether they receive Him or not is up to their repenting and exercising faith. But we have got to keep the blade sharp. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We don't pussyfoot around people's eternal destiny. And so the first work of God is conviction. Now notice the response. He says, each one of you, in verse 38, must turn from your sins, repentance, metanoia, and turn to God. And then you must give evidence of your conversion. How many have ever heard people? Well, I gave my life to Jesus 35 years ago. I've been backslidden for 30. Baloney, you've been backslidden for Jesus. Don't talk to me about, listen, when you're a Red Sox fan, you look like a Red Sox fan. You wear the hat, you wear the jersey, what? You act like it. What you are, you are. You display that. Amen. When I first got saved, I heard about people, I've been backslidden. You never got saved, brother. Don't feed me that line of baloney. I read too much of church history and I read the book of Acts. Listen, you He said, when you get saved, as you're in the process of giving your life to Jesus, there's going to be something required of you. You got to go public. You got to come out of the closet. You got to be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Why? You got to make a public declaration of the miracle that's happening inside your soul. Amen?
Amen?
Don't you hide that under a bushel. And you know what? They did get baptized. 3,000 of them got baptized. Now, so he gives a challenge, urges them to repent. And what happens? The Spirit of God, who now incarnated the body of Christ, men and women, 120, now they are infilled with the Spirit. Why? For the purpose of proclaiming the gospel. They start telling everybody. People now are getting saved. 1, 2, 10, 20, 100, 1,000, 3,000 people repent and apologize to Jesus Christ that they had him crucified, and now they are crying out to God. Can you imagine being there at the first church service when 3,000 people, black, white, and Asian, are giving their life to Jesus? My God Almighty, was that an amazing church service or what?
Mm-hmm.
These are people who did not speak Aramaic. But God loved them so much, he broke the barriers of languages down. He infilled the disciples, and he said, go tell them I love them. Go tell them hell is hot and heaven can be theirs. So they explained the life and the ministry of Jesus in their own way, in a language they've never studied. It's amazing. And one by one, by dozens, by hundreds, by thousands, 3,000 people are probably bawling their eyes out in the Solomon's porch. And it is the greatest revival that has ever happened in the history of the church. Now, these people are going to end up going back. We're close to this. These people are going to end up going back to their nations. Africans, Arabians, Mesopotamians, Elamites, Medians, Parthians, Cappadocians, Phrygians, and the list goes on and on. See, God is not willing that any should perish, but that what? All means everybody. Jesus had them all come to Jerusalem because that was the city of God, the city of the great king. And now from Jerusalem, he sends them back to their homelands, preaching the gospel of Christ in a way that they could understand. Remember, they probably hung around for a couple of months being discipled. Now, follow, as we share the gospel with our neighbors here in the Metro Springfield area, it is important that we mentor and follow them up. Pastor, isn't that what we pay for? No. That's everybody's job. Amen?
Preach it.
I don't hear it. That's everybody's job. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So now everyone, the 120 are now ministering. Can you imagine the fruit 3,000 people say? Let's close with verses 40 through 47. Then those who gladly received the word were baptized. That's all they 3,000 were saved. They backslid? Is that what the Bible says? They just did whatever the heaven they wanted? No, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, breaking bread, and prayers. Verse 46. Whatever they felt like it? No, they continued daily with one accord in the temple, breaking bread house to house. Were they bummed out about it? No, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God, having favor with everybody. That's our responsibility. Why are we having these classes, these discipleship classes? Because you are going to disciple people. Amen? It has always been the business of the Church of God, for the Church of God to disciple people who just gave their life to Jesus or are not yet born again but are interested in the things of God. Amen? The devil hates that everyone can serve God. You don't have a pastor who has a complex like, you know, gosh, if everybody starts serving, I'm out of a job. It is my job to help everybody serve Christ and preach the gospel. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to close with this. This is a church on fire. Can this be replicated? Yes. It must be replicated. And when it is, it's an act of God. It happens this way. We must forgive each other. So there's nothing between us. No air between us. Tight. must be fellowship around the Word of God. We must talk with one another about how God can use us, right? We don't want to talk just about the Red Sox or I love the Sox, but when we get to come together in this place, we talk about God the Father's business. Amen? God writes it down in the book of Malachi, a book of remembrance. We've got to talk about people coming to know Jesus. How many of you love the service last Sunday with Dr. David Berman? Amen? Can I get a praise for that? A little church of four people with two people, four people that were mentally challenged, okay? And there's a little church of like 350 people turning Southern New Hampshire upside down. There's Pentecost happening here every Sunday! And one of these Sundays, we're all going to go on Saturday. We're going to go up there.
All right.
Four people's house. They're going to love you.
Yeah!
They're going to treat you like royalty. We're going to go for a Sunday service and they're going to forget. Because we want what they have here. Watch our stuff. Amen? Our stuff. Not going to be somebody else. We're going to be who we are. But last thing, I want you to think of this. These things that I mentioned are the characteristics of a church that's on fire. A famous evangelist was asked, why is there no revival in America? Dr. Larry Pelton said, an old evangelist said, well, the reason we're not having revival in America is because American Christians are content not to have fully grow. I'm not content not to have patients. I'm a registered dental hygienist. I went to college to take care of people's health. Some of you have other professions. You were trained to go to work. Amen? You just don't punch in and sit down and steal from your employer. You got trained to work. Amen? Is that too much to ask? God saved us, and the work of the gospel is everybody's business. And we got saved, and we got filled with the Spirit to serve and to go and win people to Jesus. Last thing, I just got a list of councils in Springfield. Lord willing, what we did 2 weeks ago in that council meeting, we're going to do that, Lord willing, seven or eight times a year in Springfield, and we're going to go around all the towns. We're going to go to business here. Why? Because we're in the business of bringing people to Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's praise the Father. We thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for Pentecost Sunday. This is just the tip of the iceberg. We did the best we could just to give a general outline. And now, Lord, revival occurs always in response to forgiveness, fellowship, and focus. We're focusing in now. We're focusing in right now on your life and your death on our behalf. You gave us your life, Jesus. Jesus said in Luke chapter 22, and I'm going to ask if I could have two people please distribute the items right now.